If we were to open up an FPGA and peek inside, what would we discover? In our previous video, we discussed the fundamental concept of FPGA. In this video, we are going to dive deeper into this topic and clear up some common misconceptions that FPGA users might have. But before we jump into that, let's quickly recap what we covered in our last video. In the previous part, we learned that we can implement any logic function using something called a lookup table or LUT. Actually, FPGAs are made up of thousands to millions of these lookup tables, and they allow us to create more complex circuits. To implement larger circuits, we break them down into smaller functions, each of which can be implemented using a single lookup table. Now, we need to connect these lookup tables to build the main circuit. To achieve this, there are already many wires in place that can be programmed to connect the lookup tables properly. And this process of connecting them is known as routing. By programming the lookup tables and the switches associated with the wires, we can construct any large circuits we desire. This process of programming the lookup tables and configuring the interconnections is referred to as configuration. What's interesting is that you can reconfigure an FPGA multiple times. For example, you might want to experiment with different circuits, test different design, or even make changes if you are not satisfied with the results. Now, let's take a closer look at the digital component inside an FPGA. If we could remove the outer cover of an FPGA and take a peek inside, we'd probably see something like the schematic I've prepared for you. Let's explore the other resources inside FPGAs aside from the two main ones we talked about earlier. I'll introduce these resources one by one and provide a brief explanation for each of them. The primary components you'll find in FPGAs are logic blocks, which are essentially the same as lookup tables. Then there are switch matrices, which are made up of wires and switches. We discussed these two resources in our previous video. Moving on, we have I/O blocks, which are circuits located behind each of the FPGA's pins. After that, we have memory block and digital multipliers. Finally, we have clock resources. Now let me give you a brief explanation of each of these components. Logic blocks, or as they are sometimes called, logic cells, are fundamental components within an FPGA. Imagine them as tiny circuits inside the FPGA. These logic blocks play a critical role in FPGA architecture, and they are essentially the same as lookup tables. Within logic blocks, there is another element called flip-flop. These flip-flops are handy for creating synchronous circuits. Synchronous circuits are those where changes happen in sync with an external signal called a clock. To make sure that the changes in lookup tables synchronize perfectly with the clock and get sent to the rest of the circuit, we use flip-flops at the output of the lookup tables. So these flip-flops in logic blocks help us design synchronous circuits. But if we don't need that synchronization, we can directly use the output of lookup tables in the rest of the circuit. You can choose between these options using the multiplexers available in logic blocks. Now let's move on to the next resource we discussed in the previous video, switch matrices. Think of these as networks of wires that you can program. With these wires, you can connect various digital resources, including those lookup tables we mentioned earlier. The next resource to consider is I/O blocks. These are circuits behind each of the FPGA's pins, and guess what? These circuits are programmable too. With I/O blocks, we have the power to decide whether each FPGA pin should act as an input, an output, or both, also known as bidirectional pins. Also, you can specify various I/O standards for these pins using these circuits. For example, you can define the current drive strengths for output pins or set voltage levels for input and output pins. This capability allows for diverse connections between FPGA and various peripherals. Another super useful resource in FPGA is memory block. If you're familiar with digital design, you'll know that you often need some memory units in your designs. Sometimes you perform calculations and want to store the results for later use. Other times, you might sample a signal and need to hold it before sending it elsewhere. In these situations, having hardware-based memory blocks already built into FPGAs is a lifesaver. Without these pre-designed memory blocks, you'd have to use lookup tables to store data. But that's not ideal for two reasons. First, lookup tables are precious resources primarily used for implementing functions, so using them for memory storage would be wasteful. Second, hardware memory blocks can boost the speed of your design, making it more efficient. Now let's explore multipliers, another crucial digital asset within FPGAs. Multiplication is a fundamental operation in digital design, especially when you're dealing with tasks like digital signal processing. If FPGAs didn't come with pre-designed multipliers, you'd be forced to use lookup tables, just like you did for memory blocks, to implement multiplications. But here's the catch. Lookup tables are often in high demand for implementing various functions, so using them for multiplication would not be efficient. To solve this problem and achieve faster multiplication, FPGAs typically include a set of pre-built hardware-based multipliers that you can utilize in your designs. Now let's talk about clock resources. Clock management is a critical aspect, particularly when you are working on synchronous circuit designs. An FPGA is essentially a large circuit, and it needs to distribute the clock signal simultaneously to different parts of itself. However, the path that the clock signal takes can have varying lengths, leading to different delays in reaching different sections of the circuit. In synchronous systems, the goal is to make sure the clock reaches all parts of the system at the same time. To achieve this, FPGAs provide mechanisms to synchronize the clock across the system. One of these mechanisms is using the frequency synthesis resource. Typically, when you are working with an FPGA-equipped board, it includes an oscillator that generates a fixed and a specific clock frequency. This clock is then supplied to one of the FPGA pins. For example, your board might have an oscillator generating a 50 MHz clock, which can be used in your synchronous designs. However, in some cases, you may need a different clock frequency for your current design, say 128 MHz. To accommodate this, you have to change the existing frequency. Fortunately, FPGAs offer hardware resources designed for this purpose. These specialized hardware resources are called DCM, or Digital Clock Manager, in older Xilinx FPGAs, and MMCM, or Mixed Mode Clock Manager, in newer ones. With these DCMs or MMCMs, you have the power to adjust the clock frequency to meet your specific design needs. Now, let's delve a bit deeper into the misconceptions I mentioned earlier. While we'll explore this topic in more detail in upcoming videos, when we discuss hardware description languages and digital implementation, let's touch on it briefly based on what we've covered so far.
You've probably written code for microcontrollers before, or if not, you might have done some programming on your computer using languages like C, Basic, Pascal, or another language. When you work with a microcontroller or computer, you're essentially interacting with a CPU, a pre-built piece of hardware that understands and executes a specific set of instructions. To use a CPU, you write code that gives it these instructions to perform a specific task. Now let's contrast that with FPGAs. When you work with FPGAs, you don't have a predefined CPU, and you don't have any specific pre-designed hardware resources ready to use. What you do have is an extensive array of hardware resources, but they don't initially perform any particular functions. For instance, imagine you want to add two registers together in an FPGA. In the FPGA world, adding two registers together isn't a simple matter of writing code like you would for a CPU. Instead, you need to design and implement the hardware for this addition. First, you have to create a hardware adder. Then, you must connect the two registers that you want to add to this adder. But here's the thing. Registers themselves don't exist as standalone entities in an FPGA. You have to design them from scratch as well. So when you are working with FPGAs, you're essentially designing hardware, not writing software. Terms like programming for an FPGA or software design for an FPGA are not quite accurate in this context.
Now, when we dive deeper into hardware description languages in future videos, you'll see that even terms like instructions don't quite fit because instructions are specific to CPUs. Instead, you'll use hardware description statements that allow you to describe how digital circuits behave. We'll delve into these topics and concepts more thoroughly in upcoming videos. So that's it for today's video. If you found this video useful, please go ahead and hit the like button. Also, hit the bell icon to be notified whenever I release a new video. Thanks so much for joining me. I'm Ahmed Saghafi, and I'll see you next time.